Good morning, everyone. Happy Resurrection Sunday plus seven, which is still Resurrection Sunday. If you all would make your way to your seats, if you're out in the lobby, we are excited to begin our time of corporate worship this morning, whether you've joined us here in person or whether you are on the live stream. Our call to worship this morning comes from John 8, verses 28 and 29, and verses 31 and 32. It takes just the words of Jesus from those sections. So there's a little bit of narration, so you can go, you know, on your own time. Feel free to check that. But we're just going to be saying as a call and just a simple call and response, the words of Jesus from that passage. So for those of you who are able, we invite you to stand at this time. When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And He who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to Him. Please pray with me. God, we are here this morning to celebrate your Son that is still risen and is still with you now. And we long for the day where He returns. But until then, we are here. And by your grace and by the power of your Spirit, we will continue to worship. We pray that you bless our time this morning. We pray that your Spirit would move in our hearts. We pray that you would open our ears and our minds and our hearts to your word as it's preached and as we sing and as we pray together. We are excited to see what you will do this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. That's the one we wanted.
Of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. 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 Thou rushing wind so strong, the clouds that sail in heaven along. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Thou rising morning, praise, rejoice. Ye lights of evening, find a voice. Let all things their Creator bless. worship him in humbleness. Oh, praise him. Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son. And praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Mark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity.
Crown him the Lord of life.
Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, who rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternally.
Good morning. My name is Matt Winant. I'm one of the deacons here at By Grace, and it's a pleasure and a joy for me to share with you the life of our church and some events that are going on this month, and pray for our time of worship. So, first and foremost, we're going to take things 1 week at a time. This Thursday, women's Bible study will be starting again. They are sticking with the two times. There's the morning at 9:30 and the evening at 6:30. They'll be starting a 7-week study on the book of Colossians. And If you have any questions, please talk to Grace Alexander, but she did mention that there will be the Bible study journals provided for you there, so there is nothing for you to bring or get before this Thursday. She will have those things for you. So that's this Thursday, and for the next seven Thursdays, studying the book of Colossians. For our young folks in the church, Connect is this Friday, the 12th, here at the church. That starts at 6:30. They always meet the second Friday of every month, so that's a rolling announcement. As we move forward, Sunday the 21st, there is a young adult event at the Alexander's home. If your age is after high school and before, I'm a young adult, I think, still, but I don't think I'll be going to that. That's at 2 to 5 at the Alexander's on the 21st. There is not an RSVP on the realm for that, but they did ask that if you plan on attending, please bring food or a drink. And again, you can talk to the Alexanders, who are not here, unfortunately, today. But if you have any questions, you can shoot them an email or the deacons an email, and we will help you out. Tuesday, the 23rd, our church continues to serve at Peninsula Rescue Mission in downtown Newport News. So there is a sign up in the lobby, and we are always searching for 3 to 4 people to come and help serve the lowest men in our community who are in need of assistance and help at PRM, a meal for that Tuesday. So there's a sign up right next to hospitality on the wall, and we're searching for 3 to 4 people. It's in the evening, and if you want to have any questions, if you haven't served at PRM before, Mark Imborski is the person who you can talk to, or any other deacons can help you with that. And we'll give you directions or kind of outline what you need to do to serve. It's very, very simple stuff. The men there are great to talk to and fellowship with, and it's a joy that we get to serve them a meal every other month on the fourth Tuesday of that month. So. The last Saturday of the month, which is the 27th, is meats and sweets. So there are a few things we do in this church that we do really well. Food is one of them. Both A, providing for people who are in need of food, and also just making food for each other. So if you are gifted in cooking or baking or smoking or grilling, I mean, any kind of food you want to bring on the 27th, to win a prize, I mean, who does not want to win a prize? I think Jeremy's the reigning champ. Harold? Harold.
I was dethroned.
I never know. It's either Matt Hausman, Harold, or Jeremy. I mean, at some point, somebody has to step up with something. But there is an RSVP on the realm for that, for just attending. There's not yet a sign up for who's bringing what or kind of job-specific things. Becca Garber will be having that information later on. But I just want to kind of point out that that's from 4:30 to 8:30. But there's a lot of prep work that happens before 4:30. So if you're available in kind of the early afternoon on Saturday to come help the deacons, usually myself, move all of the chairs in the sanctuary and put some tables up, I will gladly accept help. That would be really appreciated. But meats and sweets on the 27th, fantastic if you can come. And then lastly, on May 11th is CareNet's Walk for Life. Sarah Lane is our liaison for that. We do have a team for By Grace, which is fantastic. In the realm, there's a link that lets you sign up for CareNet for the Walk for Life. And then there's a section where you can pick By Grace Community Church as your team. So there is an easy way for you to access that. So those are kind of what's going on in the life of our church. There are more things on the realm. If you make sure you check the realm announcement page as well. But with that, let me pray for our time together before we dismiss children for Children's Church. So please pray with me. Come, blessed Spirit, author of all grace and consolation, show me my sin in all its worst colors, that I may feel an unwavering hatred of it. Show me the majesty and mercy of God in such a way that my heart will not be alarmed and melted. Convince me, O you blessed Spirit, of sin, righteousness, and repentance. Show me that I have undone myself, but that my help is found in God alone, in God through Christ, in whom alone you will extend compassion and help me. Show me the power of Christ to save. I teach my faith to see him extend on the cross, arms wide open, with a piercing, bleeding side, telling me what room is in his heart for me. May I know what it is to have my whole heart subdued by love, so subdued as to be crucified with Christ, to be dead to sin and dead to the world, but alive to God through Christ Jesus. May I confide in his power and love. May I commit my spirit to him without reserve. May I bear his image, observe his laws, and pursue his service. And through time and eternity, may I remain a monument of the power of the gospel and a trophy of his victorious grace. O blessed God, if there is any secret sin yet lurking in my soul, anything I have not sincerely renounced, show me and tear it out of my heart, even if it has shot its roots ever so deep and wrapped them all around, so every nerve will be pained by the separation. Tear it away, Lord, by your graciously severe hand. By degree, by speed, perfect what is still lacking in my faith. Accomplish in me all the good pleasure of your goodness. Enrich me, Heavenly Father, with all the grace of your Spirit. Form me into the complete image of your dear Son. And then, for his sake, come to me and manifest your gracious presence in my soul until it is ripened for glory. Amen. At this time, we dismiss children for Children's Church out the double doors. You can meet your teachers in the lobby. We will continue our worship with the giving of God's times, God's tithes, and our offerings.
And we invite you to stand at this time as well.
Victory. nation, O ruler of all.
Please be seated.
Good morning. You have your Bibles with you. I invite you to open up to the book of Galatians. Today we're going to continue our journey going verse by verse through Galatians. Today we're going to pick up Galatians chapter 5, beginning in verse 7. This is the word of God, such that when the Bible speaks, it is God speaking, and we should hear it and receive it that way. Galatians chapter 5, beginning in verse 7. You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view, and the one who is troubling you will bear the penalty, whoever he is. But if I, brothers, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. I wish those who unsettle you would emasculate themselves. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we gather here this morning because you are worthy. First and foremost, O God of heaven, you are worthy. You're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our time. You're worthy of our song. We ask, O Lord, that you would continue to reveal yourself to us. Lord, we acknowledge that as we come here, we can have all kinds of situations and circumstances compressing upon us. We could be battling illness. We could be frustrated in relationships. Lord, we need you to tell us the truth about who you are, the truth about who we are, the truth about all that you have done to rescue us. Come and make that plain to us. Oh God in heaven, give us eyes that we would see you and your beauty. Give us ears that we would hear your voice and have the certainty and conviction of your spirit. And that you would give us hearts that yearn for you, for your ways, for the things that you love. And give us the enabling power of your spirit that we would forsake those things for which you died to deliver us from. Come and meet with us, your people. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. All God's people agree. Amen. This is, of course, the fifth chapter of Galatians. We are entering into the application of rich and deep theology to the daily life of God's people. There have been many truths taught thus far, many truths reminded as Paul writes to people who know him, more importantly, know Christ. They know the good news of a bloody cross and an empty tomb. But they, like we, can easily forget, can easily corrupt, can easily forsake the way of the truth. The gospel is, of course, not about what we do for God. The one true gospel is about what God in Christ has done for us. That is the nature of the Galatian heresy as we've seen it exposed and explained. The Galatian heresy was that they were beginning with the grace of God and then trying to finish under their own power, according to their own obedience. So as we pick up where we left off last week, we do so entering into one of Paul's most common metaphors for talking about the Christian life. If you read the letters of Paul, you will hear this phrase over and over, this walking out of the Christian life. Sometimes it's a running after the Christian life, as though it were a race, a marathon of life and faithfulness to engage in, not to secure God's favor, but because you have his favor. Walking out, walking, running is the most common metaphor Paul uses to describe the Christian life. And we can see this as we begin here in verse 7. You were running well. He's not talking about a fitness program. He's utilizing the imagery of the ancient Greek games. Did you guys know that there used to be games played in Greece? What do we call those games today? The Olympics. Anybody love the Olympics? I love the Olympics. I don't get to watch as much now as I have in other seasons of my life, but whether it's the winter version, which I marvel at, or the summer version, which can leave me gasping for air and I'm not even doing the exercising. They had these sorts of games in their day. So when Paul says you were running well, he means you had begun the Christian life, but something happened. Not you lost your salvation, but that there was introduced a hindrance. You see that word hindered? That word hindered means essentially impeded. Their progress was impeded. Somebody and something was interfering with their race. You could even think of it simply as somebody tripped them. You know that tripping is cheating, I hope. But the idea of impeding your opponents is one I think most of us who are familiar with sports understand. But there's an interesting dynamic here, twofold. The first, in their day, they did not run on the oval tracks as we do today. They, in fact, ran from a starting position to a pole far away, rounded that pole, and then returned. You ever done this in gym class? Where you run to the line and back, and inevitably somebody is in your way causing you to break your stride. The faster people get to the pole, make the turnaround, and then all of a sudden there's a field of obstacles. You've got to navigate your way through other people running at their full speed or jogging. It is easy to imagine that there was a lot of impediments. The race itself was filled with people who are obstacles. Hindered, when literally translated, is cutting in. Now, if you've been here for this study, is the word cut a magic word as Paul uses it? He's a master wordsmith, make no mistake. He is trying to draw the connections and help them understand, much as I am here to do. But when they began the Christian life, they did so well. They received the good news from Paul, the good news of the cross and the empty tomb. And they were off and running. But someone came in cutting off their path, cutting off their advance. So this is not just a metaphorical impedance. It's a literal one as well. Someone came in, a person or a group of people, proclaiming a false gospel, teaching them wrongly, and that was cutting in front of them and stopping, halting, slowing down, or outright making it impossible for them to keep running. Listen to the language. You were running well, and then the question, who hindered you from obeying the truth? To be cut is how God makes covenant, yes? To be cut off is to be removed from. And the Old Testament is filled with this imagery, especially when you start to think about the sign of circumcision and the purpose of circumcision. It fits within the larger construct of covenant life. So when we see that they are cutting in and hindering the Galatian Christians from obeying the truth. That's an interesting phrase too, if we think about it. Somebody cut in, somebody stopped their progression, somebody redirected them away from the purpose for which they were running, and this is seen by Paul as hindering their obedience to the truth. It's another great play on words here. If I ask, what is the truth? We would start talking about the exclusive claims of Christ, right? What is the truth? Well, the gospel is the truth. The good news is the truth. The creation of God, the fall of man, the redeeming life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the promise that one day all things will be made new. God, sin, Christ, new heavens. That is the good news. But there's also a sense in which the truth is not just a message. He is a person. Jesus is the way, the life, and the truth. John 14:6. So when we see that they are hindered in their obedience to the truth, there is something getting in the way of them living this Christian life. But we've also seen Paul use this phrase, the truth of the gospel. You can see it in Galatians chapter 2, verse 5, and also in Galatians chapter 2, verse 14. One of the things you'll discover in the remaining chapters is that Paul is going to be self-referencing in his use of language. Sometimes when we seek to understand what an author is saying in a general sense, we try to find their words in multiple places and in multiple contexts to see if there's a relationship between how they're using the words from one place to another. Well, here we see Paul speaking about the truth of the gospel. So when we see this phrase, obeying the truth is a reference to the gospel he's been proclaiming, teaching, demonstrating, using metaphors, using Old Testament scriptures to explain and illustrate. But they are hindered from obeying the truth. There's a purpose to their race, is there not? Is there not a reason why they are running to the pole and back? Yeah. John Stott, as he meditated on this in his commentary, says this, The truth is not just something we believe. It is also something to do. Not to earn God's favor for salvation. That's my editorial. But here's the rest of the quote. Our creed is expressed in our conduct. And our conduct is derived from our creed. You get that? So what we believe then leads to, is distinct from, but necessarily leads to, outward expressions. So when you think about what James, the brother of Jesus, is talking about in James chapter 2, this is the sense in which he's talking about justification. Not for the securing of salvation, but for evidence of the outpouring work of salvation. What we believe informs what we do. Orthodoxy and orthopraxy. So what Stott is trying to say, our creed is expressed in our conduct, means if we really believe the gospel, there are elements of it that will manifest in how you live, what you think, what you do or don't do. Not for the securing of favor or approval, but because it's the natural, designed by God, outworking of what we believe. Now, do we forget what we believe at times? Do we fail to live up to what we believe at times? Of course. That is not the sense in which it's being discussed here. What Paul's saying is, people are meddling with your fundamental understanding of the gospel, and as such, they are knocking you off course or taking you out of the race. Because the truth is not just something we believe. It's also something that works its way out in our life. Why else does God give us his Spirit? If not for the conforming of us to Christ. So someone, something, has hindered their Christian race and is leading them to no longer obey the truth, no longer conform to the truth, no longer profess the truth. And then in verse 8, we get another editorial. He says, this persuasion is not from him who calls you. In other words, this hindrance, this message that is tangling up your feet, this message that is interrupting your life and your thoughts and your prayers, it is not from God. It is a false message. That's how he's using the word persuasion here, meaning that someone else has come in and taught you something that you are now either believing or tempted to believe, and that is what is hindering your walk with Christ, hindering your race. In other words, this persuasion, this message, this argument, what is coming from these false teachers is not divine. In fact, taken in the context of the whole letter, it's demonic. It's a scheme of hell. It's from the father of lies, not the father of grace, who loves us by grace. In other words, legalism in all of its forms come from the father of lies. Our heavenly father is the one who calls us, yes? Our heavenly father is the one who called them. Notice that phrase at the end of verse 8. This persuasion is not from God. God is the one who called them. How do we know that? Because we've seen this phrase before in Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. him who called you. Paul's writing in the first chapter in the past tense. In this chapter, he's writing the same phrase, the same comment, the same identifier of who God is. God is the one who calls you. And what he means is this call is still happening. You are still being received into and understanding the gospel itself. They have not forfeited the gospel unless they forfeit the gospel. You understand the duality there? If you seek to be saved by your works, you are giving up divine grace. Remember the heresy that Paul's battling here, the heresy that is hindering these churches, is a formula of salvation where Jesus is a necessary component, but he's insufficient by himself to bring salvation. You must add a little or a lot of your obedience. You must add your human works, what you do or don't do, what you love or don't love, to what Jesus has done. And when I say it like that, it becomes easily rejectable, I hope. But you're running a race right now, are you not? What hinders your race? What cuts in and knocks you off course? What trips you up in your walking out or running out of faith? It's when we try to add Moses to Jesus that we forfeit what God has said. When we seek to add our righteous deeds to Christ's righteous deeds, we forfeit Christ's righteous deeds. It's like multiplying by zero. You ever multiply by zero? What do you get as an answer? It's amazing how powerful zero is. If I do 5,000 times zero, I get 5 million times zero? Half times zero? Zero. Jesus plus nothing is right standing with God. Jesus plus nothing. And anything you would add is the very snare around your feet. Anything you think you must add to the life and death and resurrection, ascension of Jesus Christ, that is what is hindering you. And the one who teaches that is a hinderer. They cut you away from the source of life, the source of renewing strength. It is not no big deal what you believe. We live in a day and age, like many others before us, where people fundamentally believe, some will actually say, doctrine is for division. Why do you care so much about doctrine? That's that cold, stale stuff that divides us. Do you agree? Doctrine is for joy. Doctrine is for comfort. Doctrine is for peace. That in the midst of all the uncertainties of this life, we know and can be certain that God is good, that God is trustworthy, that he's powerful, and that he alone is all wise. Is that not your comfort in the midst of your confusions? Is that not your comfort in the midst of uncertainties? I may not know all that is to come, but I know who controls all that is to come. I don't have to know what the future holds. I know the one who holds the future. Is that not for your joy, peace, comfort? Sometimes correction. Do you want to be corrected? We might answer, where? In front of whom? How often? But fundamentally, the Christian faith has in its core a need for correction, a need for renewal, a need for a mind switch. We need a new heart, new eyes, and new ears. We need a new body, which will come someday. So when we see that this persuasion, this message, has come in and hindered their race, and we understand that it is not a message that comes from God, then how are we to view these false teachers and their false message? Paul gives us a very popular proverb. Verse 9. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. We got any bakers in the room? Anybody like to bake bread? All right, I got like a couple of very shy hands. Is there anybody in the room that likes to bake bread? There you are. What is fun about making bread? Eating it. Sure, there's craftsmanship. Sure, there's different recipes and different ways, but you need yeast every time to make the dough rise. Now, sometimes you want to order a thin crust pizza. I don't know why, but you do it. And you're hoping the dough doesn't rise very much. If you're like me and human, what you really want is a nice, thick... I'm glad you guys are laughing. It seems like a silly proverb to have to explain, right? That you need a little lump of active yeast in a small piece of dough so that you can put that yeast in the fresh dough and roll it up and push it around and leave it, because invisibly and incredibly, that active yeast will create the air pockets that serve as the structural integrity for a moment as the dough rises. It was Micah Lamb who started to teach me, because I was in that kingdom group for a few years, and Micah loves to bake. He's a doctor who wishes he was a baker. How many bakers wish they were doctors? But I was amazed because he would consistently talk about, ooh, I got a new starter. And I'm like, you got what? Where? What? And he would get excited because he would do some change, some recipe, some new way of creating the same sourdough bread with a different tweaked formula. So he would break off a new starter to continue that vein. It's sort of like growing your own yogurt, which is apparently a thing you can do. But it's a metaphor that lots of us can understand because we've eaten bread and seen the air bubbles, yes? But it's also deeply rooted in Israel's history. Think back to Exodus 12. At the time of the Exodus, at the time before God would free and deliver his people from slavery in Egypt, leading them out to the wilderness for a while, and then into the promised land. Right before they left, what happened to their starter dough? They got rid of it. All of it. In fact, metaphorically for them, it was considered sweeping the sin right out of their lives. In Exodus, as part of their annual remembrance of the Passover, they were to get rid of all of the leaven from their homes. In other words, what Paul is doing here in verse 9 is likening the Galatian heresy to leaven. A little bit of false teaching will cause evil, it will cause sin, it will cause wickedness to work its way into and through all the churches of Galatia. In other words, a pinch of law thoroughly contaminates the whole gospel. A pinch of law thoroughly contaminates the whole gospel. So what is this Galatian yeast? The Galatian yeast was to add works to faith as the basis for their justification before God. In other words, the Galatian yeast must be swept away, seeking to add their obedience to the law of Moses, to their trust in Jesus Christ's life, death, and resurrection, forfeits Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. This is a cancer that consumes the gospel. Should we be opposed to good works? By no means. Should we be leery of people who talk about good works? No. Unless they're saying it's necessary for salvation. If you are adding to what Jesus has done, then you don't know who God is and what Jesus has done. You're corrupting the message, and it is a leaven that works its way through the whole dough. So as Paul confronts them and illustrates that the heresy that's hindering is understandable as a yeast that corrupts, he also offers, and this is very overlooked, a pastoral and shepherding blessing in this verse. He has confidence in what the outcome of this will be. Did you catch that? Verse 10? Listen carefully. Paul says, I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view. Paul not only thinks he's writing the letter because God has told him to do it, Paul believes that when the gospel is clearly portrayed and put before them, and the heresy identified and explained, that they will reject the false gospel. They will sweep away that leaven. And the hindrance to their running will be removed. Paul believes that God has begun with them. Does God ever fail to finish what he has begun? Let's try that again. Does God ever fail to finish what he has begun? No, that's why Paul has confidence. Paul doesn't have confidence in their intelligence. Paul doesn't have confidence in their pragmatism. Paul doesn't have confidence in his argumenting abilities. He doesn't have confidence in anyone or anything but the Lord. And that Lord he knows, that Lord who calls, who has called to the Galatian churches, the people within. Yeah, that guy finishes what he starts. That guy sweeps out the leaven. He might do it miraculously. He might do it in a providential way that we cannot suspect. But we will recognize after. But the most common way that the Lord sweeps away the leaven is in and through his people and what they say and what they do. Confidence is not in us. It's in Christ at work in us. It's in Christ at work through us. How does faith come? By hearing. By hearing anything? By hearing the word of God. How do you think faith is renewed? By hearing the word of God. As Paul teaches them, is he giving them an argument? Is he offering them his wisdom? No. This is a divine giving. And what is being given to the Galatian churches in their day is being given to you. God finishes what he starts. So in verse 10, he can bless them in the midst of their discomfort. Is getting hindered comfortable? Anybody like it when the guy across from you is tripping you, cheating against you? No. But here we see in honestly very subtle and easily missable way that Paul is recognizing the humanity and the personal nature of their struggle with this false doctrine. He knows the power of the leaven. He knows the destructive nature, the corroding effects of a false gospel. He was committed to that false gospel before some of these Galatians were born. Paul wants them to reject the obstacle of his life that he in Philippians 3 says belongs in a toilet flushed away. That's why Paul's words are so strong. And it's why his agitation is growing again. You remember the fire of the start of this letter? I know it was like 10 years ago. But when we started this letter, do you remember the fiery nature? Let him be anathema. If I or an angel of heaven start meddling with the gospel, may they be eternally damned. I don't think you get more fiery than that. Well, some of that fiery passion is rising to the surface again in this letter. Some of his agitation, not against the Galatians, but against those who would speak this hindrance, against those who listen to and serve the father of lies. He has righteous agitation. Yes? So as he continues, he's blessing them that he has confidence in the Lord that they will take no other view than the gospel. But also, for a moment, he turns his focus on the false teacher, the one who is troubling you. The one who is the obstacle, the one who is hindering you running the Christian race, living the Christian life. And he is once again not going to be anything but righteous in the way he conceives of and talks about these false teachers. I will take no other view. the one who is troubling you will bear what? The penalty? Is this like a flag on the play kind of penalty? Is this like eventually one of those referees is going to figure out how you're cheating? Oh, no. Oh, no. This is a promise that the righteous judge, the one who gives his divine grace to his people, will bear upon the false teacher a penalty. This is an eternal penalty. This is not a flag on the play penalty. In other words, those who trouble them will come to an unhappy end. That's the kindest way a commentator put it. They will come to an unhappy end. I prefer the way this commentator said it. Every false teacher will be judged for every false word. That's more specific than an unhappy ending. I can have 10 unhappy endings in a day. This is an eternal judgment by the one who has perfect clarity, perfect knowledge, perfect awareness. He knows exactly what they want and how and why they wanted it. This gives me comfort in the midst of righteous rage. If I see some knucklehead on TV lying about who Christ is and what he's done, I can get kind of steamy inwardly. I know that totally surprises you, right? That I could be fiery. Every false teacher will be judged for every false word. That also sobers me. I don't want to give you thoughts that Kevin has. I want to give you the word of God because that's all I want. It's all I can trust. But it's also a little scary, sobering to say, I will be accountable for what I say in this pulpit or in your living room. I plead the blood of Christ on my failures. But I take comfort that the liars and deceivers, the manipulators, they will be judged, and they will be judged righteously. And vengeance will be God's, not ever mine. The penalty is divine judgment. Every false teacher judged for every false word. And here, we don't know if Paul knows the name of this guy or his group. We've called them the Judaizers. We've called them those from Jerusalem who came to spy on the freedom that they have in Christ. But even if Paul does know his name, he's not giving him the fame of recording his name, whoever he is. But then he turns to himself for that same self-examination. Verse 11, but if I, brothers, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. In other words, Paul's saying, if you think that fundamentally we're preaching the same thing, you don't understand that I'm not. In fact, my great evidence is my great persecution. Everywhere I go, everybody tries to kill me. Everybody tries to put me in jail or beat me to death. I even got stoned and left for dead. If I'm preaching Judaism, which is an approved religion by Rome, why do I suffer so? No, my message is different. Because you're wrongly understanding circumcision. You're wrongly understanding the giving and purpose of the law. And because I teach the difference, that is how I know that our message is different in my persecution. That's an evidence of such, that Paul's message is fundamentally different than that of the false teachers. There is only one gospel. All other pretend or faux gospels are not good news. They are bad news. And they hinder or lead you astray in your walk with Christ. Remember a moment ago when I was talking about agitation and wordsmithing and being clever in how you put together these things for the purpose of clarity and understanding? Well, Paul gets a little fiery, and his fiery here is righteous sarcasm. Time out. Did you know that sarcasm has a righteous form? Every teenager goes, sweet, teach me about that. There is, just as there's righteous anger and flawed anger, there is right here in this verse, righteous sarcasm. Paul's going to make a statement wishing a knife would slip to a consequence that would be unforgettable. But I warn us. Dr. Longnecker said one time, that what he says in verse 12 is the crudest and rudest expression in all of Paul's writings. Verse 12, what's coming, is the crudest and rudest expression in all of Paul's writings. So understand that this is not to be sanitized. It might make you blush. Good. I hope it doesn't make you confused, unless you're of a less mature age. In which case, just smile and nod and never ask your parents. Brothers, if I, verse 11, still preach circumcision, why am I being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. Verse 12, I wish those who unsettle you would emasculate themselves. I wish that those who want to find their righteousness in the small cutting of the foreskin in flesh would go the whole way. Take the whole member, because that is what they are doing to the gospel. Neutering it. Castrating it. Now that's a cutting remark. Agreed? It is a cutting remark. And it is crude. It is vulgar language. It is a vulgar and violent quip, but it is not unjustified. It is not unrighteous. It is a righteous conclusion to the severity of their obsession with the cutting of a covenant or a foreskin. But there's more to verse 12. Pagan religions, in fact, had a religious rite of castration. This is not something we know much about. But listen to Dr. Ryken. Some pagan religions required castration. The priests of Sibylle, for example, who lived in northern Galatia, were made eunuchs at an annual festival. So perhaps Paul was saying something like this. Look, if you want to insist on getting circumcised, then you are trying to be saved by a ritual. But that's just another form of paganism. So you might as well go the whole way and become one of their priests. Now that has a greater clarity, but also a greater sting. He's saying your false gospel is not new. It is pagan. Your understanding of righteousness is not new. It is pagan. And in fact, if you want to see the pagan ritual on display clearly, you can go north to the churches above you and around you and hang out at this annual festival where the priests of Sczebel castrate themselves. Can you imagine the kind of religious fury you would have to coax up to do that to yourself? R.C. Sproul reflects on it this way. He says, if you want to follow these pagan notions of the Judaizing heresy, then you might as well include with it the rite of castration, the ceremony of castration. Are you uncomfortable yet? Me too. Every word, yes. All of God's scripture, yes. There's also another element. There's a third layer here. Paul is also very familiar with Deuteronomy 23, verse 1, which says, no one whose testicles are crushed or whose male organ is cut off shall enter the assembly of Yahweh. In other words, they are excluded from the covenant and from the presence of God if they are castrated, which is another way of saying to sweep the leaven out of the church, these false teachers should go the whole way, emasculating themselves, and thereby be cut off from the church. You see that? In other words, Paul's using, this is not a real mic, they should go the whole way and castrate themselves. It's a mic drop. It's the full summary of their whole worldview. It's the best, most polemic way to underscore the severity of what is being discussed. Castration is no small thing. Castration is no small thing. Done by others or done by yourself. What on earth do we do with this? What on earth do we do? In exposing pagan rituals, in understanding polemically the power of what he is saying, the image he's using to say it, I think we can agree it's offensive. Anybody feel offended? I'm offended. I don't delight in talking about this. But it's holy scripture. How much do you trust God as he speaks in his word to lead us, guide us, teach us, and guard us? I wish the knife would slip or you would travel north. Verse 12 is offensive, but I think most of the modern church is offended by Paul's use of vulgar vocabulary and not so much about the exclusive claims of Christ. If you really want to know what the most offensive thing in what he just said is, it's not the castration. It's the perversion of the gospel that he has to illustrate to that severe, unmistakable image. So I ask us, are you okay being offensive in pointing to Christ? That's the application for today from this passage. Is the offense that you take, because Paul used some gutter language to teach about heavenly truth? Or is the offense that there is one way to heaven and no other? I think we're afraid of being offensive because we care more what man thinks than what God says. I think we fear being exposed as Christians. Exposed as one of them. Rather than in humility, with gentleness, with truth, offering them a crucified Christ. What's the offense of the cross? That it's hard to look at? It's hard to think about God in his flesh cut to ribbons? In the agony of the nerves in his feet? The agony of the nerves in his hands or wrists? Is the offense of the cross that Jesus gasps for air for hours, and that suffocation is what finally kills him? Pushing up on his feet to draw breath and slinking down to the jarring fall and jostle of every nerve ending, and doing it again to draw breath and fall and rise for breath and fall, and then eventually, instead of rising for breath, he remains fallen and breathes his last and dies. Is the grotesque imagery of the cross the offense of the cross? Or is it that that unavoidably declares the most unflattering evaluation of who you are? That something that heinous is a cost that is required to save you. Let's not quibble about strong vocabulary in God's word. Let's quibble about how sinful we are. Let's focus on the real offense of the cross. And it is not the language Paul uses in verse 12. It's what he's referencing in verse 11. The offense of the cross. When you add your unrighteous and righteous perceived by you alone acts to what Christ has done, has suffered, has accomplished, then you, my friend, are offending the God of glory, the God of grace and mercy. The offense of the gospel is the exclusive claims of the gospel. Number one, that you need saving. Two, that you cannot save yourself. Three, that you can't even contribute anything to your salvation. And four, there's no other way to be saved. There's no other name given among men by which we must be saved. To preach circumcision is to preach salvation by human merit. It's to say that my contribution is essential for my own salvation. That is a condemnable lie whispered by the father of lies through the age of man. To preach the cross is offensive because it singularly attacks what we love most, our pride. So I ask you, brothers and sisters, do you want to be popular or faithful? Do you want to be popular or faithful? Galatians 1:10, Paul has already given us his answer. He says, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." All the leaven givers are not servants of Christ. The offense of the gospel is that it took a crucified Christ to pay for our sin and a perfect Son to secure all blessing. And the two are one. Two natures. One God. In his one person of the Son. In other words, the cross is the most unflattering assessment of your unrighteousness, of your best efforts. And it is the greatest news I have to give. Amen. Don't create an offense for the cross. Let the cross itself be the offense in our proclamation. Amen? Amen. Heavenly Father, we ask, O Lord, that you would lead us to trust you. O God in heaven, we ask that you would not only be merciful to us in our many failures, that you would give us much grace in the time of need, but also, Father, that you would confirm for us your presence and power, leading us to proclaim that you alone save, that we are saved not because of faith we possess, but because of the gift of faith that you have given, that we would see and believe and grab hold of Christ by your Spirit's work. So save, O Lord, and lead us to believe and to live this gospel we love. And all God's people agree and request.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
We invite those of you who are able to stand as we sing in response. Also, parents, please head to the lobby and pick your children up from Children's Church.
The mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend. The agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, crush your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Perfect sacrifice I've been brought near. Your enemy you've made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness. away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Lover of my soul, I want to
silence is forgivable. Offense, unnecessary offense, it's forgivable. Fear, failure, disappointment, distrust, all these things that can preoccupy us are forgiven at the cross. So as we come as a church body to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, we do so understanding the promise of the gospel, that the shedding of his blood, the sacrifice of his body, is more than enough for us, more than enough for our salvation, more than enough for our justification, our adoption, and even, yes, our sanctification. Look, I'll be clear. This sacrament is not for perfect people. It was originally performed and offered by the perfect person. So if you're a perfectionist and you're thinking today, I don't know if I should come and take the supper. Repent, believe, and come. This is Jesus' table. It is for his people. Now, if you are not yet a believer, that doesn't mean there's nothing for you in this moment. For you, consider the claims of Christ. Consider the leaven of your sin. And ask, O Lord God, could you be the answer to the problem of me. This is a moment that is holy for the believer who comes and feasts and for the non-believer who considers the claims of the gospel. But as we come to the supper as a body here at By Grace, we come confessing our need for Christ and the sacrifice of the cross. We also come confessing the glorious truth of what we believe in God's redemptive plan and action. So today we're going to turn our attention to a corporate confession of sin. And what this means is that we are letting somebody else's words speak about what we hold as true. And so as we confess together, we confess our need for a Savior and His saving work. So, as the confession comes up on the screen, would you all confess together? Holy Father, forgive us. Though you should guide us, we inform ourselves. Though you should rule us, we control ourselves. Though you should fulfill us, we console ourselves. For we think your truth too high, your will too hard, your power too remote, your love too free, but they are not. And without them, we are of all people most miserable. Heal our confused minds with your word. Heal our divided wills with your law. Heal our troubled consciences with your love. Heal our anxious hearts with your presence. All for the sake of your Son, who loved us and gave himself for us. Amen. Isn't that a glorious presentation of what's true about us? His will too hard, his truth too high, his power too remote, his love too free. Brothers and sisters, this is a sacrament for you to come as an act of faith, trusting Christ, tasting bread and juice or wine as a way of God saying to us, he's that close to us. And he loves us so much, he wants us to have him so much that he gives us a tiny taste, a tiny remembrance of what we will eternally celebrate and receive forever. The holy presence of God. But let us also be assured of our pardon. I don't have the power to pardon your sin. Christ has the power. And Christ has the pleasure of atoning for and removing your sin. So listen to the psalmist. This comes from Psalm 28. Blessed be Yahweh, for he has heard the voice of my pleas for mercy. Yahweh is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts, and I am helped. My heart exults, and with my song I give thanks to him. He heals what is broken in his people. Hallelujah. So we're about to serve the supper. And I invite the officers of the church who are going to assist me in that service to come forward. And as we do, I'll remind us that we will invite you shortly to take some time for personal, silent confession, thanksgiving, intercession, a time of personal prayer. And then when you are ready, we invite you to come forward and receive and consume the elements. There'll be two stations, one on my left and one on my right. I remind us that the wine in here is red, the grape juice in here is white, and that there are gluten-free wafers available in the center tray when it is served. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we ask, Lord, that you would set apart these elements, that you would take these ordinary things, juice, wine, bread, and that you would sustain us, feed us, nourish us in your goodness, according to your great and abundant mercies. And we ask, O God, that as you anoint these things and this season and time and moment, that you would bless ordinary and make extraordinary. We confess freely our dependence and gratitude on you and to you, and we ask, Lord, that you would lead your people not to search for our imperfections in this moment, but rather that we would behold your perfections and rely upon you alone, as you have taught us to do in the gospel. We ask you to do this in the name of Jesus Christ. All God's people agree. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is something that you should take and eat, for it is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And also in the same manner, on the same night, he took the cup, and having given thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Drink from it, all of you."
to fear, leaning on the
everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms, leaning on the everlasting arms. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
We plead only the precious blood of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
The gospel is ours to treasure. It is also ours to proclaim. So the question I have for you to consider today or over lunch is, what are the obstacles you face or have faced that cut in, that hinder your walk with the Lord? And, or, what are the obstacles that you have found the people you love have for understanding or believing the gospel? Does that make sense? All right. Benediction comes to us from Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth. Child of God, receive your Father's blessing. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forever. And all God's people agree.
Amen.
Amen.